afternoon, this is Russell Davis celebrating the art, craft and inspiration of the popular song. And it's all about songwriters today. We have to say farewell to one veteran who's just left us, one of the few women songwriters of the classic era. And we have the man of the moment when it comes to writing the standard songs of tomorrow, Duncan Lamont. Not only a writer, but a musician. And as I hinted a few weeks ago, Duncan was there playing the saxophone solos on one great songwriter's London recordings.
You're just too marvelous, too marvelous for words, like glorious, glamorous, and that old standby amorous. It's all too wonderful. I'll never find the words that say enough, tell enough. I mean, they just aren't swell enough. You're much too much, and just too very, very too ever be in Webster's dictionary. And so I'm borrowing a love song from the birds to tell you that you're marvelous, too marvelous for words. Just too very, very to ever be in Webster's dictionary. And so I'm borrowing a love song from the birds to tell you that you're marvelous, too.
Johnny was lovely. I remember, I think it was the second day, and I was walking into the studios, and Johnny was just coming in as well, as we were walking downstairs together. And I said, Johnny, you sounded great yesterday. He said, I just want to sing like Louis Armstrong or Fred Astaire. I mean, I didn't know Johnny. It was only, you know, the recording experience, but he was great.
The voice of Duncan Lamont, who at the age of 71, he told me, no secret then, is about as fashionable and productive a writer of songs as there is in the world today. Fortunately, Duncan was trained in the best possible way because Johnny Mercer wasn't the only songwriting legend he made records with.
I did an album with Arthur Schwartz. That was fun. That was lovely. I actually sat next to Arthur. He was singing. The guy announced him, and of course nobody in the band knew who he was, except me. So it was like, oh, who's this? Who's this old guy, you know? And Arthur was great. He was great fun, actually. The thing was, I had a solo in Dancing in the Dark, and Arthur was next to me, and I thought, do I play the melody? Maybe I should play the melody, you know? But the thing was, he was more nervous than I was. You know, he kept saying, was that all right? Was that all right? I said, Arthur, you sound wonderful. I said, you sound like Fred Astaire, because he had that same type of light voice. I don't know if you've heard Arthur sing very much.
I've got the album somewhere, yes.
Yeah. So that was nice. A few strings and a small front line. It was great.
Dancing in the dark till the tune ends, we're dancing in the dark. And it soon ends, we're waltzing in the wonder of why we're here. time hurries by, we're here and gone, looking for the light of a new love to brighten up the night. I have you, love, and we can face the music together, dancing in the dark. We're dancing in the dark, and it soon ends. We're waltzing in the wonder of why we're here. Time hurries by, we're here and gone, looking for the light of a new love to brighten up the night. I have you, love, and we can face the music together, dancing in the dark, dancing in the dark, dancing in the dark.
Singing his own melody, Arthur Schwartz in London in 1975, at Chapel Studios, actually, with sax solo once again by Duncan Lamont, not playing the tune. Duncan's real friend among the songwriting community was the late Matt Dennis.
Matt said to me, "Duncan, what are your aspirations?" I was over there, you know, at his house. I said, "Matt, I'm just trying to write Angel Eyes." Sometimes I play and I play very well. Sometimes I play and I don't play very good. I've written arrangements for all types of orchestras and whatever. Some of them are very nice and some of them aren't very good. But if you write one song, that's enough. Just one.
Try to think that love's not around, still it's uncomfortably near. My old heart ain't gaining no ground because my angel eyes ain't here. Angel eyes, that old devil sent, they glow unbearably bright. Need I say that my love's misspent, misspent with angel eyes tonight? So drink up, all you people, order anything you see. Have fun, you happy people. The drinks and the laughs on me. Pardon me, but I gotta run. The fact's uncommonly clear. Gotta find who's now number one, and why my angel eyes ain't here. fun, you happy people. The drinks and the laughs on me. Pardon me, but I gotta run. The facts uncommonly clear. Gotta find who's now number one and why my angel eyes ain't here. Excuse me while I disappear.
Sung by Nat King Cole with the Billy May Orchestra, that was Angel Eyes by Matt Dennis and Tom Adair, the sort of song that Duncan Lamont always aspired to writing. But of course, he does have a signature song of his own. It's been around for a while now, but it's gaining new admirers every year.
I think I'd probably always been, you know, dabbling at writing, but I never really bothered too much. And then I had a group with Pat Smythe, and Sandra King was in the group. And Sandra used to say to me the night before the gig, write a song for tomorrow. And I used to write a song. I talked to her during the break, during the tea break. And when the guys came back, we recorded it. You know, it was a wonderful, white, hot creation time, you know. She said, I need a song for tomorrow. Write a song. And one of them, I don't know if it was the first one or the second one, but it was I Told You So. And so Sandra was the first one to sing that.
And by no means the last. Since we'll be hearing Sandra King in a moment, I'll play the latest recording of I Told You So that I've heard about, and that's the one that appeared on last year's huge-selling CD album by daughter of Nat, Natalie Cole.
I heard it on the grapevine, straight from the horse's mouth. They're saying all that he's heading north and you're going south. I hate to say it, but I told you so. Before the curtain fell, I told you so. I've known for a long time it couldn't last. Now you're just a memory in his long and distant past. How can you tell someone who is starry-eyed? Her Dr. Jekyll's really once, but that was long ago. Well, I told you so. To say that I told you so, but he's losing interest, and you feel like a bore. Then one day you wake inside to hear a closing door. How can you tell someone who is mystified? Champagne's
I loved him once, but now the scars don't show.
Natalie Cole and the Duncan Lamont song I Told You So, a version that could make a difference to his bank balance. But then again, it might not.
The truth of the matter is that when somebody records a song, you think like Cleo or Mark Murphy or Blossom, the various, you know, people pretty well known, people think that I'm making a fortune. You don't make very much money from songs. But, I mean, Natalie's thing might do. I don't know. I haven't a clue. But, I mean, I've made much more money from library music, sitting down for 5 minutes and writing a little thing. So it's a labour of love, really. But it's a nice way to pass your life, you know. It's good fun.
Duncan writes words and music, a habit that grew out of a disappointing experience he had with an attempted collaboration some years ago now. Again, the influence was involved of Matt Dennis, a man whose company I much enjoyed on the one day that I met him.
Oh, he was great, yeah. Wasn't he?
Yeah.
He was angelic. He really was. Wonderful guy. I recorded some of his songs on a broadcast and sent them to him, and he phoned me and said, there's a song on there without a lyric. He said, is it yours? And it was a thing I'd written. He said, I'd like Tom Adair to write a lyric for it. And I thought, oh, this is great. You know, Violets for Your Furs, etc. A couple of weeks later, thing arrived with that beautiful American copying and said, Silent Walls, Tom Adair, Duncan. I thought, oh, this is fantastic, you know. Then I started reading the lyric, and it was just all right. Do you know what I mean? It was okay, but it was just professional, but didn't mean very much. So I was doing a broadcast that day with Pat and Sandra. And I said, what do you think? You know, I showed it to Pat, who was a very good judge of, you know, material. And he said, well, it's just all right. And Sandra looked, she said, well, it's just all right. Pat said to me, he said, Duncan, why are you bothering about another lyricist?
And since that time, he's never needed one. Here's one of his words and music pieces, which was brand new in 1996, when Sandra King recorded it with the piano of Sir Richard Rodney Bennett.
An empty space, an empty place, a kind of silence fills the room now. I touch a chair, an empty chair. Somehow the silence grows and grows. Picture on the wall, and yet it's strange, somehow it's changed. I hardly know this room at all. An empty bed, an empty space. I dream my dreams, and I watch the world and see your face and wonder who can fill the quiet and empty space. Another time, another place, I close my eyes and you're beside me. We're lost in space, a timeless place where we can watch a flower grow. We lived for life, and life was love. We sang a very special song, but isn't it strange how things can change? I still don't know where we went wrong. An empty bed, an empty space. I dream my dreams and you're beside me. I watch the world and see your face.
It was really Matt who got me started. You know, he kept saying, you know, write more and suggesting things. Like, for instance, I wrote a tune called Fred Astaire. I did a jazz club broadcast and I'd written this little tune, and Sandra phoned me the night before. She said, write a tune for tomorrow. And I looked at this thing and I thought, I'll write a song about Fred Astaire. And she recorded it the following day. I sent it to Matt and he said, look, send it to Fred. He said, he'll love this tune. I want you to do it. He said, look, this is his address. Don't give it to anybody else. Tell him that I think that he'll like it. So, but 2 years went by. I never sent it, you know. Every time I spoke to Matt, he said, have you sent the song yet? So I finally sent it. I came back from holiday, and there was a letter, Beverly Hills, and opened it. It was from Fred Astaire. And I've still got the letter. It's typewritten. And he'd underlined all the nice things. And then he had signed it with that beautiful autograph, which I knew because I'd worked with Fred and Bing Crosby. And I got him to sign an autograph book for my children, you know. Fred died several months after that. So, I mean, that is an historic letter, really, to have. Yeah. Isn't it great?
the unmistakable Blossom Dearie on a CD Duncan Lamont kindly brought along with him. I've never owned it. It's called Tweedledum and Tweedledee and features Blossom with the piano of Mike Renzi instead of her own.
I started, you know, going up to New York and seeing Blossom, and we became very good friends. Then she recorded four of my songs on that Tweedledum, Tweedledee, whatever. She's just recorded quite a number of my songs. I think the last one was this thing called Make Some Magic that she did, that Johnny Mandel added a little bit as well. But the nice thing is, and I'm sure you feel the same, that we meet great people, don't we? Like legends. And when I think of my life, it's just unbelievable, the people I've met, you know. And the people who've been so encouraging, Benny Carter and Johnny Mandel and Marty Page. All those people are like dear friends of mine. It's really nice feeling.
From that same Blossom Dearie CD, Tweedledum and Tweedledee, and a Duncan Lamont song packed from the title onwards with little turns of phrase that people commonly use in speech. It's the way he fits them together that makes them special. He knows all there is to know about singers through long years as a session man, playing with and behind them. And that title, Not You Again, reminds me of a story he tells of a singer he played with many times over the years, Frank Sinatra.
One year, the fixer phoned up and he said, Frank is doing a week at the Albert Hall, because Frank used the same people all the time for about 20 years. He said, well, the money is whatever it was. I said, that's terrible money. I really don't care about money. I said, it's the principle of the thing. I said, I get more money last week working for Harry Secombe at the Fairfield Hall. Johnny, I said, I'm sorry. No, that's an insult.
Nevertheless, Duncan did find himself persuaded into the band, but he exacted a small revenge.
My evening suit was looking a bit shabby. I suddenly remembered I had a brown evening suit. And I thought, well, he's not paying good evening suit money. I'm going to wear my brown evening suit. So anyway, we're doing the Albert Hall, and there's that bull run, or whatever it's called. You know, Frank would come out, they all plot. Yeah. Sinatra would come out. And as he walked out, I was at the end of the section with this really very nice brown evening suit, but it was brown. And he sort of looked. And then he went on and did his act. And then when he finished, come on, they're all applauding. Sinatra! And he'd sort of look at my suit. And this went on for the entire week. And the following year, I got a call from this fixer who said, Duncan, Frank's coming back. I said, oh, yeah. He said, did anything happen the last time? I said, well, not really, apart from the money was terrible. And he said, well, there's a chart that we have here, and there's a chart in New York where you were sitting. There's a big cross saying, don't book this man again.
Baby, you went and broke your faithful promise. How could you do a thing like that to me? Didn't I give you everything I promised? How could you do a thing like that to me? Never thought you'd be untrue. When my back was turned on you, if someone gave me all the world to hurt you, I wouldn't do a thing like that to you.
Sinatra in suitably outraged mode, and that's the only record in this hour of the programme that has no direct connection with Duncan Lamont. Frank Sinatra, of course, was the great survivor. Susanna McCorkle, as it turned out, wasn't. Unavoidably, her tragic suicide makes us listen in a slightly different way to her records, including those where Duncan Lamont himself stood in for saxophonist Danny Moss.
I remember the first time I worked with her, I did a few gigs, and I played and she said, Duncan, will you be my next husband? It's great. No, she was lovely, actually. And I saw Susanna probably a year before she died. I mean, it's just terrible.
Yeah. Was it, you know, professionally things were slowing down, or your emotional life, or...?
There was a history of manic depression in the family. And once that happens, it doesn't matter what's happening to you. It can be wonderful things. And if it's there, I'm afraid it's there. Yeah, sad.
Life was so peaceful at the laundry. Life was so calm and serene. Life was tray-gay till that unlucky day when I happened to read that magazine. Why did I read that advertisement that said, since I rumba, Jim thinks I'm sublime? Why, oh, why did I ever try when I didn't have the talent? I didn't have the money, and teacher did not have the time. Mom, Martha Murray, taught me dancing in a hurry. I had a week to spare. He showed me the groundwork, the walking around work, and told me to take it from there. Arthur Murray then advised me not to worry. It'd come out all right. To my way of thinking, it came out stinking. I don't know my left from my right. The people around me can all sing a one and a two and a three. But any resemblance to waltzing is just coincidental with me. 'Cause Arthur Murray taught me dancing in a hurry. And so I took a chance. To me it resembles the 9-day trembles, but he guarantees it's a dance. Turn pale. My conga goes into a goose step till the FBI is dogging my trail. 'Cause Arthur Murray taught me dancing in a hurry. Maybe the stars were wrong. If I ain't a minister, Ruth St. Denis, I'll do until one comes along. You cut a rug, ball the jack, back to back, Lindy Hop, till you drop cheek to cheek, till you're weak. You've heard of Pavlova, well, Jack, move over, make way for the queen.
A Johnny Mercer song written with Victor Schertzinger. Arthur Murray taught me dancing in a hurry. Sung with brio by Susanna McCorkle. With a bit of flute by Duncan Lamont. I haven't noticed any titles as long as that in Duncan's own output of songs, although there are many I haven't seen.
Well, yeah, I've probably written about at least 200 songs. The nice thing is that some of the songs have moved people very much. As a matter of fact, when Norma sings Manhattan in the Rain, she says it's embarrassing. She said there's people crying in the audience. And that's happened with a number of my songs. Sandra came over one time, Sandra King, and she was doing a broadcast the following day. She went to the piano. She said, "What does that say?" And there was my terrible scrawl. And I said, "It says Manhattan in the Rain." And she said, "Well, how does it go?" And I said, "I don't know, actually." I said, "But it's just about 3 or 4 notes." I imagine something like rain going down a window pane, you know, somebody looking out. And she's always very kind. She said, "Oh, I like that title." So Bridget, my wife, and Sandra, they went upstairs, and I stayed up, and in the morning I'd written this song, you see. So Sandra was getting ready to go, and I said, "Sandra, before you go," I said, "I've written this song, Manhattan in the Rain." So I played it. And she said, "Oh, I really like it." So my wife said, "I can say without a doubt that is the worst song I've ever heard in my life." She said, "It's like a voice exercise." She said, "It's terrible." And I said, "Yeah, I'm inclined to agree with you." I said, "I don't like it either." Sandra said, "I think it's nice."
Well, we can only decide the argument by listening to the song. The Norma referred to, whose rendition has been known to produce tears, is Norma Winston.
Thank you. caught in mid-Manhattan in a swift midsummer downpour. I was caught with no umbrella and I couldn't find a taxi. Everybody ran for cover and the traffic stood like cattle in the rain. Finally, I saw a cab and ran and held my hand up. But I didn't notice someone else was running for the taxi. And we bumped into each other, and then both of us went sprawling in the rain. What a strange, enchanted way to meet someone in mid-Manhattan, in the rain. You were so apologetic, I was so embarrassed, but you helped me to my feet, and then we both said it was our fault. And we laughed and introduced ourselves and shared that yellow taxi in the rain. Later on, we had a dry martini in a bistro, and we sat and talked for hours, just like a scene from some old movie. But we knew that something special seemed to happen in that bistro in the rain. What a strange, enchanted way to meet in mid-Manhattan, New York, in the rain. But nothing stays the same, does it? People change, don't they? And all those bright, wonderful dreams start to come apart at the seams. Pathway down my window, and I slowly draw a circle, and I watch the waiting taxi as I watch you throw your bags in. Then I know I won't be seeing you again. Suddenly taxi's gone and taken my life with it, and the rain-soaked streets are empty. Then I see two people sharing an umbrella, and I watch them smile and close my eyes and live it all again. Isn't it sad to fall in love and say goodbye in mid-Manhattan in the rain?
Now, this is the funny part. I was doing the song in a club in Pittsburgh. And a guy came up and said, I would like a copy of that song because I'm a voice professor. I want to use it as a voice exercise. So my wife was right.
Was right all along.
Some of the 200 or so songs have come in batches. For example, he once handed over 10 Christmas songs to Blossom Dearie, and instead of choosing between them, she recorded the lot.
But it seems when somebody says to you, you know, produce me a song quickly, you can do it every time. I mean, you must be very prolific.
Well, yeah, I said that once to Dave Frischberg, you know, because Dave gets some writing blocks. I said, Dave, I might not be good, but I'm prolific. He said, that's better than being good. Dave's a funny guy.
I'm impressed with my attorney, Bernie. I'm impressed with his influential friends. He's got very big connections, and I follow his directions. Bernie knows his way around, and so I always do what Bernie recommends. I am blessed with my attorney, Bernie. I'm impressed with the way he runs the store. He's got Dodger season boxes and an office full of foxes. It's amazing all the different things your average guy might need a lawyer for. Bernie tells me what to do. Bernie lays it on the line. Bernie says we sue, we sue. Bernie says we sign, we sign. I'm in touch with my attorney, Bernie. In a clutch, he can speed right to the scene. And if I'm locked up in the jail with just one phone call for my bail, he said to call his club collector, deal directly with his answering machine. When I dine with my attorney, Bernie, he buys wine from the rare imported rack. That's because Bernie is purist, not your polyester tourist. Bernie waves the glass around a while, then takes a sip and always sends it back. Bernie tells me what to do. Bernie lays it on the line. Bernie says we sue, we sue. Bernie says we sign, we sign. Bernie, I admire any guy who knows his stuff. Sure, we blew a couple ventures with the counterfeit debentures, but you win a few, you lose a few. Like Bernie says, you keep on hanging tough. Thanks to you, my attorney Bernie. Thanks to you, I'm considered well-to-do. Sure, I made out like a bandit, just exactly like you planned it. But like Murray, my accountant, told me yesterday, I owe it all to you. Bernie tells me what to do. Bernie lays it on the line. Bernie says we sue, we sue. Bernie says we sign, we sign. On the dotted line.
Dave Frischberg's own version of his song My Attorney Bernie, the best-known version of which is the one by Blossom Dearie. You do get the sense of a benign sort of circuit underlying these exchanges of songs. Incidentally, on the 20-year-old album where My Attorney Bernie appears, Dave Frischberg says it arose from an occasion when a friend of his, Tim Brown, a Minneapolis attorney, asked him for a song commemorating Tim's 25 years with the firm. In real life, Dave said, my attorney's name is Mort, and he used to play bass with Louis Armstrong. Remarkable sort of lawyer. He never sends the wine back, he says in conclusion. Dave Frischberg is the missing link in modern music, as far as I'm concerned, and the sooner somebody organises some British engagements for him, the better I'll like it. Meanwhile, returning to that circle of friends of Duncan's, Johnny Mandel is prominent among them, as we've heard, providing not only musical support and advice, but also the odd title.
So happened, I was going to be in New York at the same time as Johnny. As a matter of fact, he said to me, hey, let's spend some quality time together. And that's how I wrote the tune.
Quality,
you know,
time.
Quality, yeah. Time. Which, incidentally, Dave Frischberg wrote a tune called Quality Time, and I was really worried about it. And I said to this mutual friend, a lady called Carl Ettman, nice singer, and I said, I've written a tune called Quality Time. She said, yeah, but you wrote it 3 years earlier, Duncan. She knew the history.
A history which has lately been expanded by a new version of Quality Time. In fact, the title track of Dame Cleo Lane's latest album, Made at Home in the Old Rectory, Wavendon. This is it.
Let's turn the lights down real low and play a CD or two. There's nothing else I'd rather do than spend quality time with you. A TV dinner for two. Our favorite brew. Somehow it tastes like mint wine when it's quality time with you. And did I mention your special face? Your most uncommon face. It's such a lovely face. In a word, I'd say, on a common place. And when the sun's in the sky, we'll still be saying goodbye. Quality time for two. Spending quality time with you.
Quality Time by Cleo Lane with John Dankworth and their son Alec Dankworth on bass. What a nice family situation. And that's all we can fit in of the oeuvre of Duncan Lamont, the most successful late flowering songwriter in the world and a regular listener to this programme, I'm honoured to say. It was wonderful to talk to him. We've been trying to arrange a meeting for some time. In part two, coming up, a small tribute to Doris Fisher. And if your reaction is, who? Then you're just the sort of inquisitive person we're looking for. First, the strains of Time Was.
This is Hubert Gregg, seated once again in the Friday night square chair and happy as ever to be inviting you back to yesterday. Do join me every week for half an hour of lyrical and musical nostalgia. We call this weekly indulgence Thanks for the Memory. Friday evenings, 7 o'clock, here on BBC Wireless 2.
And this is 88 to 91 FM, and we call it Radio 2 from the BBC.
And the news now at 4 o'clock. This is Andrea Simmons. An independent commission has been set up in Texas to try to discover why the space shuttle Columbia disintegrated just minutes before it was due to land. All seven crew members were killed in the accident, and debris has been scattered over a 500-mile radius. The commission will look into whether damage suffered to the craft's wing on takeoff was responsible. Earlier, President Bush led prayers in his local church in Washington for the astronauts who lost their lives. Prayers have also been said at the American Church in London. A senior official in Iraq has said his country is keen to make progress during the next round of talks with the chief UN weapons inspector, Hans Blix. Mr. Blix has been invited to Baghdad next weekend, just a few days before he presents another report to the Security Council. From Baghdad, Mike Wooldridge.
General Hossam Mohammed Amin said he hoped differences and misunderstandings could be overcome, but he said nothing to signal that there could be a breakthrough soon on two key issues. What was still preventing any private interviews with Iraqi scientists, General Amin said, was their personal decision that they wanted to be accompanied by officials or witnesses. He again said the government couldn't force them to answer the inspector's questions in private. And on the issue of allowing U-2 surveillance flights as part of the inspections process, General Amin said Iraq still wanted an assurance that American and British aircraft would not carry out any attacks in the Iraqi no-fly zones while such flights took place.
At least 30 people have died in an explosion in the Nigerian city of Lagos. The blast ripped through a bank in the city's business district, destroying the building. There are reports of violence and looting as people tried to grab money which was blown into the air. Two men are being questioned about the murders of a prominent loyalist and another man in Belfast. John Gregg of the UDA and another member, Robert Carson, were shot in the docks area of the city as they returned from a football match in Glasgow. The leader of the House of Commons, Robin Cook, has repeated his preference for a largely elected House of Lords. His opinion contradicts that of the Prime Minister, who favours an appointed second chamber. Here's our political correspondent, Carol Walker.
Downing Street say the whole point of a free vote is that people should be free to express their opinions, but it is rare for a cabinet minister to challenge the Prime Minister's views so openly. Tony Blair has warned that an elected House of Lords could rival the Commons and create gridlock in getting legislation through. But Robin Cook says he believes a largely elected second chamber is right in principle, so that people know they've chosen most of its members. He points to a recent opinion poll showing hardly any support for an all-appointed House and says it's important to carry the public in this long-awaited reform.